فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله واستغفر لذنبك وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات والله يعلم متقلبكم ومثواكم.
أن أمته ستفترق على 73 فرقة كلها في النار إلا واحدة، وهي من كان على مثل ما عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه. ولا يهولنك كثرة الجمع، فالحق هو الحق، وإن لم يأخذ به إلا واحد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the ever merciful. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord, Creator and Sustainer of all things. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafi anbiya'illahi. And may Allah raise the rank of and grant peace to the most noble of all prophets and messengers, Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walahu. And likewise all of his family, companions, and those with true religious loyalty and allegiance to him. Amma ba'd, as for what follows, that on this afternoon of the fifth day of the month of Safar, in the year 1438, we come together here at al-Masjid al-Awwal, in the city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, along with our brothers in various masjids and centers in the state of Florida, through the efforts of our brothers at the Tarbiyah initiative of South Florida. May Allah Ta'ala grant them an increase in success. We begin at this time continuing in our reading of the explanation of the great scholar, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Saalih al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah Ta'ala, to the book al-Usool ath-Thalaathah, the three fundamental principles. And we've reached page 76 in that book. And that is, after finishing our discussion of the meaning of the testimony that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, we now enter into the next statement of the author. And that is what is found on the top of page 76. قال شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله. Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdil-Wahhaab, may Allah have mercy on him, stated, وَدَلِيلُ الصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَتَفْسِيرُ التَّوْحِيدِ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى. And the evidence for prayer, for the payment of zakat, and as well that being an explanation of a tawheed, comes in the statement of Allah the Most High, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ. And the people of the book of old, they were never ordered with other than worshipping Allah, making their religion sincerely devoted to Him as hunafa, devoutly sincere worshippers, and establishing the prayer and paying zakat, and that is the religion of uprightness. That's from Surah Al-Bayyinah, the fifth verse. In explanation of this topic, this verse being used as a proof for three matters: salah, prayer, zakat, the payment of zakat, and Tawheed being explained with these and other matters. Shaykh Muhammad bin Saalih al-Uthaymeen says, أي الصلاة والزكاة من الدين. This means that salah, prayer, and zakat, the payment of zakat, are from the religion. Meaning, what's the textual evidence for that? قوله تعالى, it is the statement of Allah the Most High, وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله. They were never ordered with anything other than worshipping Allah, مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاء, making their religion sincerely for Allah as حُنَفَاء, devout people of worship of Allah alone, وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ, and that they establish the prayer, وَيُؤْتُ الزَّكَاةَ, and that they pay zakat. Again, the fifth verse of Surah Al-Bayyinah. وهذه الآية عامة شاملة لجميع أنواع العبادة. This verse is general and all-inclusive of all matters that are worship, that are considered to be worship, all categories of worship. فَلَبُدَّ أَن يَكُونَ الْإِنسَانُ فِيهَا مُخْلِصًا لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. So, as a result of this verse, it's a must that a man be sincere to Allah in all acts of worship, in all their categories. حَنِيفًا, a man of upright tawheed, مُتَّبِعًا لِشَرِيعَتِهِ, in following of his legislation. هذا من باب عطف الخاص على العام. And he says about the statement of Allah Ta'ala, وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُ الزَّكَاةِ, and they offer the salat and they pay the zakat. He's explaining here why would Allah Ta'ala mention these matters after he has already generalized these things with the statement, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ. They were never ordered with anything other than that they must worship Allah. And that worship includes salat, zakat, and so many other things. So then why does Allah mention that they were ordered to worship Allah and to establish the prayer? There's that and. Are they two different things or are they one and the same? The Shaykh says, هذا من باب عطف الخاص على العام. This is from the manner of presenting ideas or concepts, a general concept first that includes the specific examples that are going to be mentioned one by one afterwards in order to emphasize the status of those individual specified elements of the generality. لِأَنَّ إِقَامَةَ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيْتَاءَ الزَّكَاةِ مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ. That is because the performance of prayer and the payment of zakat are both from the generality of worship that they have already been ordered to do. وَلَكِنَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى نَصَّ عَلَيْهِمَا. However, Allah, the Glorified and Most High, has mentioned them with a text, with a nas. He has mentioned them textually, لِمَا لَهُمَا مِنَ الْأَهَمِّيَّةِ, due to the importance that both of them have. فَالصَّلَاةُ عِبَادَةُ الْبَدَنِ. So prayer, for example, is the worship done by the body. وَزَكَاتُ عِبَادَةُ الْمَالِ. And the payment of zakat is a form of worship done with one's wealth. وَهُمَا قَرِينَتَانِ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. These two acts of worship, they are mentioned, coupled and paired together often in the Book of Allah, the Mighty and Majestic. Regarding the statement of Allah, ذلك, ذلك دين القيمة, the phrase ذلك, that is the religion of uprightness. That, أي عبادة الله مخلصين له الدين حنفاء, the worship of Allah with sincerity, making the entire religion sincerely for Him as people of upright tawheed. That and وإقامة الصلاة وَإِيْتَاءُ الزَّكَاةِ, and as well the establishment of prayer and the payment of zakat. ذلك, all of that is دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ, the religion of uprightness. And what is the religion of uprightness? أي دِينُ الْمِلَّةِ الْقَيِّمَةِ, the religion uprightness. الَّتِي لَا إِعْوِجَاجَ فِيهَا. There it says لَا إِعْوِجَاجَ, and of course that Hamza is Hamza Twasal. لَا إِعْوِجَاجَ فِيهَا, that religion that has no crookedness in it. لِأَنَّهَا دِينُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, because it is the religion of Allah, the Mighty and Majestic. وَدِينُ اللَّهِ مُسْتَقِيمٌ, and the religion of Allah is straight in its course, direct, not crooked or curvy in any way. كَمَا قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, as Allah the Most High has said, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ, and that this is my path, the straight path, so follow it. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُ السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَن سَبِيلِهِ, and do not follow after the various paths, meaning the paths of deviation, because they will split you away from his path. That's the 153rd verse of Surah Al-An'am. وَهَذِهِ الْآيَةُ الْكَرِيمَةُ. And so this verse, this noble verse, كَمَا تَضَمَّنَتْ ذِكْرَ الْعِبَادَةِ وَالصَّلَاةِ, as it contains mention of worship in general, and salat specifically, فَقَدْ تَضَمَّنَتْ حَقِيقَةَ التَّوْحِيدِ, but includes as a result the reality of tawheed, the worship of Allah alone, وَأَنَّهُ الْإِخْلَاصُ لِلَّهِ, and that it is to purify one's actions of worship, making them for Allah alone, عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, the mighty and majestic, مِنْ غَيْرِ مَيْلٍ إِلَى الشِّرْكِ, without any inclination towards polytheism. فَمَنْ لَمْ يُخْلِصْ لِلَّهِ لَمْ يَكُنْ مُوَحِّدًا. So whoever doesn't offer acts of worship with sincerity to Allah, then he has not embodied tawheed. He has not been a muwahhid, a person of tawheed. وَمَنْ جَعَلَ عِبَادَتَهُ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ, and the one who makes his worship for other than Allah, لَمْ يَكُنْ مُوَحِّدًا, as well, he has not been a person of tawheed. He is not a muwahhid. So the Shaykh mentions two kinds of people here to review that. One kind of person, he may do his actions for Allah alone, but he doesn't do them with ikhlas for Allah alone, with absolute sincerity. So he may have only made hajj and only made salat for Allah, but others have a share in his intention because he's showing off or seeking some gain from the people. وَمَنْ جَعَلَ عِبَادَتَهُ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ, and whoever has made his worship for other than Allah with direct and open acts of shirk, then لَمْ يَكُنْ مُوَحِّدًا مِنْ بَابٍ أَوْلَى, and he is not a person of tawheed, even more so and more obviously. وَدَلِيلُ الصِّيَامِ, back to the text of al-Usool al-Thalaathah, and the evidence for fasting as an act of worship is قوله تعالى, is the statement of Allah the Most High, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ, O you who have believed, fasting has been prescribed upon you, كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ, as it had been prescribed upon the people before you, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, in order for you to attain taqwa, piety. And that is the 183rd verse of Surah Al-Baqarah. In commentary, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Saalih al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he said about siyam, about fasting, أي دليل وجوبه, the evidence for fasting being an obligation. قوله تعالى is the statement of Allah the Most High, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام, O you who have believed, fasting has been ordained upon you as a duty, كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم, as it had been ordained as a duty upon those before you, لعلكم تتقون, in order for you to attain piety. وفي قوله, and in the statement of Allah, كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم, as it had been ordained as a duty upon those before you, فَوَهِدُ, there are some benefits. أولاً, the first one, أَهَمِّيَّةُ الصِّيَامِ, the importance of fasting. حَيْثُ فَرَضَهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ عَلَى الْأُمَمِ, as Allah, the Mighty and Majestic, had made it an obligation upon the previous nations. مِنْ قَبَلِنَا, those who came before us. وَهَذَا يَدُلُّ عَلَى مَحَبَّةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لَهُ, and this proves that it is a matter that Allah the Mighty and Majestic loves. وَأَنَّهُ لَازِمٌ لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ, and it was a matter that was made as an obligation upon every nation, the nations before us. That's the first benefit. ثانياً, the second benefit from the statement of Allah Ta'ala, كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ, fasting is a duty as it was made a duty upon those who came before you. التخفيف على هذه الأمة, to lighten up the affair for this nation, حَيْثُ إِنَّهَا لَمْ تُكَلَّفْ وَحْدَهَا بِالصِّيَامِ, indicating to them that they have not been singled out with the duty of fasting. الَّذِي قَدْ يَكُونُ فِيهِ مَشَقَّةٌ عَلَى النُّفُوسِ وَالْأَبْدَانِ, that duty which could contain with it some types of difficulty upon people's psychological states and upon their bodies as well. An obligation that has some difficulty in it to fulfill, we have not been specified exclusively with the performance of that duty. Rather, we are like every nation of the past, required to fast as they were required to fast. That helps a person take on the duty, and it makes that duty seem easier upon a person, that this is just one more duty that the people of the past, just like me, had to fulfill. نعم ثالثاً, and the third benefit from that part of the verse, كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبَلِكُمْ, as has been written upon those before you, the third benefit is الْإِشَارَةُ إِلَىٰ أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَىٰ أَكْمَلَ لِهَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ دِينَهَا, a reference to that Allah the Most High has completed and perfected for this ummah its religion. حَيْثُ أَكْمَلَ لَهَا الْفَضَائِلَ الَّتِي سَبَقَتْ لِغَيْرِهَا, as Allah Ta'ala has completed and perfected all virtues that had been established for the previous nations and gathered them and gave them to this nation as well. وَدَلِيلُ الْحَجِّ, and the evidence for Hajj as an obligation that goes along with our Tawheed, قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, is the statement of Allah the Most High, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, and the people have upon them, due to Allah, a duty of Hajj, Hajj to the house, whoever is able to make the way. وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ, and whoever disbelieves, then verily Allah is free of need. Allah is self-sufficient, free of need of anyone in the creation. That's from Surah Ali Imran, the 97th verse. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullahu ta'ala, commented saying, regarding the statement of the author, وَدَلِيلُ الْحَجِّ, and the evidence for Hajj, he said, أَيْ دَلِيلُ وُجُوبِهِ, the evidence for it as an obligation. قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, is the statement of Allah the Most High, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ, and for Allah is a duty upon the people, making the Hajj, the pilgrimage to the house, to the end of that verse. The Shaykh continued saying, وَهَذِهِ الْآيَةُ نَزَلَتْ فِي السَّنَةِ التَّاسِعَةِ مِنَ الْهِجْرَةِ, this verse was revealed in the year 9 after Hijrah. وَبِهَا كَانَتْ فَرِيضَةُ الْحَجِّ, and along with this verse came the obligation of performing Hajj. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ قَالْ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, however, Allah, the Mighty and Majestic, has said, whoever is able to make the journey, whoever is able to make a way to it, فَفِيهِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَلَا حَجَّ عَلَيْهِ, this proves that whoever is unable to make the journey, then there is no obligation of Hajj upon him. And regarding the end of that verse, في قوله تعالى, regarding the statement of Allah the Most High, وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ, and whoever disbelieves, then for sure Allah is غَنِيٌّ, all self-sufficient, free of need, عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ, of any of the creation. In this statement, دَلِيلٌ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ تَرْكَ الْحَجِّ, this proves, there is evidence for the statement that anyone who abandons Hajj, مِمَّنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, from those who have the ability to make a way to get to Hajj, يَكُونُ كُفْرًا, that is a form of kufr, disbelief, وَلَكِنَّهُ كُفْرٌ لَا يُخْرِجُ مِنَ الْمِلَّةِ. However, it is a kind of kufr, disbelief, which is categorized as lesser. Disbelief, that which does not take a man outside of the religion. عَلَى قَوْلِ جَمْهُورِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. That is according to the position held by the majority of the scholars. لِقَوْلِ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنِ شَقِيقٍ. That is based upon the statement of Abdullah ibn Shaqiq. كَانَ أَصْحَابُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَا يَرَوْنَ شَيْئًا مِنَ الْأَعْمَالِ تَرْكُهُ كُفْرٌ غَيْرَ الصَّلَاةِ. The companions of the Messenger of Allah, may Allah raise his rank and grant him peace, they did not view any action, the abandonment of any action at all, to be kufr, disbelief, other than the abandonment of salah. And that hadith is authentic, and that is collected by al-Imam al-Tirmidhi in his Jami'. Then in the text of al-Usool al-Thalaathah, we have the statement, al-martabatu al-thaniyah, and then the second level of the religion, the first one being what? Al-Islamu, and we covered the meaning of al-Islam and its five pillars. And now we have the second level of the religion, which is al-Iman. It is Iman. وَهُوَ بِضْعٌ وَسَبْعُونَ شُعْبَةٌ. And it is 70-some branches. فَأَعْلَاهَا قَوْلُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The highest of which is the statement, none have the right to be worshipped other than Allah. وَأَدْنَاهَا إِمَاطَةُ الْأَذَى عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ. And the lowest branch of which is removing a harm from the way of the people. وَالْحَيَاءُ شُعْبَةٌ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. And shyness and shame, a sense of shame, is a shu'ba. It's a branch from the branches of faith. Here, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala explains that al-thaniyah, al-martabatu al-thaniyah, the second level of the deen, ay min maratib al-deen, from those levels or categories of the religion, al-iman, faith. Al-imanu fil lugha, linguistically, the word iman means at-tasdiq, it means belief, like theoretical belief, as a linguistic meaning. Wa fi shar'i, in the legislated Islamic definition, it means i'tiqadun bil qalbi. It is a belief that is held in the heart. Wa qawlun bil lisani, and it is a statement that is upon the tongue. Wa amalun bil jawarih, and it is actions performed upon the limbs. Wa huwa bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba, and it is 70 some branches. 70-some, the word in Arabic is bid'un. Bid'un is kind of a strange word, so Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen explains it as being بِكَسْرِ الْبَاءِ بِضْعٌ مِنَ الثَّلَاثَةِ إِلَى التِّسْعَةِ. It's a number that means anywhere from 3 to 9. So it's less than 10, but it's more than one or a couple. So it's like our English word 70-some, or 70 and a few. You can say a few is a bid'un, a few. Because you wouldn't use the word a few in English to refer to two, nor one, of course. And you wouldn't really use the word a few to refer to 10 and more. That's a lot. So a few people came. You have a similarity here between the two languages. A few people came, bid'un, like a nefer. A nefer also in Arabic means a small group between 3 and 9. So a small group came, and you would say between 3 and 9. So that's a bid'un. So bid'un, there are 70 and bid'un branches of faith between 73 and 79. 70 some branches. And the Shaykh says regarding removing the harm from the way of the people, أي إزالة الأذى وهو ما يؤذي المارة من أحجار وأشواك. It is to remove a harm, the things that harm the people who walk upon the walkways, of sharp rocks and thorns, وَنُفَايَاتٍ, of garbage, you could say, or waste. وَقُمَامَةَ, another word for garbage and waste. وَمَا لَهُ رَائِحَةٌ كَرِيهَةٌ, things that have bad smells. وَنَحْوُ ذَلِكَ, and similar things. And then regarding الْحَيَاء, the sense of shyness or shame, the Shaykh says, الْحَيَاءُ صِفَةٌ إِنْفِعَالِيَّةٌ, it is an attribute that takes place within a person. تَحْدُثُ عِنْدَ الْخَجَلِ, it takes place along with a resistance because of shyness, bashfulness, these kinds of matters. وَتَحْجَزُ الْمَرْأَةُ عَنْ فِعْلِ مَا يُخَالِفُ الْمُرُوءَةُ, it's something that prevents a person from taking part in matters that would affect his standing, affect his integrity. وَالْجَمْعُ بَيْنَ مَا تَضَمَنَهُ كَلَامُ الْمُؤَلِّفِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, and to bring together the two ideas mentioned by the author, may Allah have mercy on him. مِنْ أَنَّ الْإِيمَانَ بِضْعٌ وَسَبْعُونَ الشُّعْبَةِ, the two matters are what? One is that iman is 70 some branches. وَأَنَّ الْإِيمَانَ أَرْكَانَهُ سِتَّةٌ, and that iman as well has six foundations. Then, النقول, we say, الإيمان الذي هو العقيدة, iman, that which is our belief system, أصوله ستة, its foundational matters are six in number. وهي المذكورة, and they are what is mentioned في حديث جبريل عليه الصلاة والسلام, they are mentioned in the hadith of Jibreel, may Allah raise his rank and grant him peace. حينما سأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الإيمان, when he asked the Prophet, may Allah raise his rank and grant him peace, about إيمان. And so he said, فقال الإيمان أن تؤمن بالله, الإيمان is that you believe in Allah, وملائكته وكتبه ورسله, and that you believe in his angels, his books of revelation, his messengers of revelation, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and that you believe in the last day, وَتُؤْمِنَ بِالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ, and believe in the qadr, the divine planning and decree of all matters, the good and the bad of it. And that's the hadith of Jibreel that we've studied many times. Here the Shaykh says to bring these two ideas together. However, are they really different? Are the six pillars of iman different than the branches of iman? Are they different? Or are the six pillars of iman the first six and the most foundational of those 70 some branches? What do you think, Abba Maryam? So the 70 some branches of faith, from them are six, and they are the pillars of iman. Your answer is the answer of Abu Bakr al-Bayhaqi, rahimahullahu ta'ala, who gathered that book called Al-Jami'u fi Shu'ab al-Imani, the collection about the branches of faith. And he mentioned in that book 77 chapters, each chapter being a branch of faith, in which he intended to be the order as close as possible to what is the actual order, the hierarchy of each level of faith being one above the other, each branch of faith. And his first branch of faith was what, Ya Abba Maryam? To believe in Allah. And the second branch of faith was what, Ya Abba Maryam? To believe in the angels. No, I'm sorry. No. Well, the book of Abu Bakr al-Bayhaqi is written. It's been written 1,000 years ago. And why he changed the order away from what is known about the hadith of Jibreel, I don't know. But he mentioned secondly, ar-Rasul, the messengers. Believe in the messengers. And then the third branch of faith is with him, belief in the angels. You could say maybe belief in the messengers is more broad, because the messengers are angels are messengers. There's some overlapping there. So then to believe in the messengers first, meaning angels and humans, and then you believe in the angels specifically, those who blow the horn, those who bring the weather, those who take the souls and breathe souls into the babies, those who are not mursalun, they're not bringing revelation or anything to the people, they are just angels. Then you have fourthly, what do you think? The books. He mentioned the Qur'an, wa al-kutub al-ukhra, and the other books of revelation. Then the fifth branch of faith from Abu Bakr al-Bayhaqi's book is to believe in the Day of Judgment. And then the sixth branch of faith out of 77 he listed is to believe in Qadr. So there's really no reason to say they don't go together and they need to be combined. The six pillars of faith are the first six of the 77 branches, according to this early compiler of hadith, al-Hafiz Abu Bakr al-Bayhaqi, rahimahullahu ta'ala. And then we'll read the last statement of our Shaykh for today, and that is what's on the top of page 80. He says, وَأَمَّا الْإِيمَانُ الَّذِي يَشْمَلُ الْأَعْمَالُ. As for the iman that includes actions, these first six branches are theoretical points. You believe in them, you affirm them. These six points don't have actions, except as lawazim, except as necessary requirements, or you could say the result of believing in the angels is that you fear Allah and don't do just anything because the angels are recording you and seeing you and so on. And you would say the belief in Yawm al-Qiyamah also requires that a man prepare for Yawm al-Qiyamah. So it's not absolutely theoretical. However, these points are, in essence, in their root, theoretical points that you must affirm your belief in Allah, His prophets, His angels, His books, the last day, and the Qadr. And each one of these points of belief has its fruits in action, but they are essentially theoretical points. Then many of the other branches are actually actions or statements that must be said and done, as the Shaykh says here. As for other branches of Iman that include actions, وَأَنْوَاعَهَا and categories of Iman and actions, وَأَجْنَاسَهَا and different types, فَهُوَ بِضْعٌ وَسَبْعُونَ شُعْبَةٌ. He said those are the 77 branches, or the 70-some branches, sorry. وَلِهَذَا سَمَّى اللَّهُ تَعَالَى الصَّلَاةَ إِيمَانًا. And thus Allah has named salat, He has called prayer a kind of Iman in His book. Just before you read that ayah, you notice that Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen considered the usool of Iman, the six pillars of Iman, to not be from the 70-some branches. That's clear from what he's saying here. Not that that excludes them from Iman, but they are mentioned separately. There are six foundational pillars, and then with these pillars you have 70-some actions and statements. That's how Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen viewed it. And Allahu Ta'ala knows best. He said, regarding how Allah Ta'ala referred to prayer as Iman, that is fi qawlihi, that's in his statement, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. And Allah was not going to cause your Iman to be lost. That's from Surah Al-Baqarah, the 143rd verse. Listen to how that applies to our understanding. قَالَ الْمُفَسِّرُونَ. The scholars of tafsir have said about this verse, يَعْنِي صَلَاتُكُمْ إِلَى بَيْتِ الْمَقْدِسِ. Your prayer that was offered to the old Qibla, which is Jerusalem, right? Al-Quds, Bayt al-Maqdis. لِأَنَّ الصَّحَابَةَ كَانُوا قَبْلَ أَن يُؤْمَرُوا بِالتَّوَجُّهِ إِلَى الْكَعْبَةِ يُصَلُّونَ إِلَى بَيْتِ الْمَقْدِسِ. Because the companions had, before the order to change the Qibla from Bayt al-Maqdis to the Kaaba, they had been praying to the old Qibla, Bayt al-Maqdis. Some of them were worried, not so much for themselves, they were worried about their dead companions, those who had passed away in the battles, who had never prayed to the direction of the Kaaba. They had only prayed to Bayt al-Maqdis, and they passed away, radiyallahu anhum, without having prayed to the Kaaba or in the direction of the Kaaba. So Allah Ta'ala revealed this verse, consoling them that their Iman was not going to be lost. Allah Ta'ala referred to their performance of the Salat to the old Qibla as Iman. And he didn't say their Salat would not be lost. He said their Iman would not be lost, which is a clear indication in the Book of Allah that Salat, which is an action, is Iman, and it cannot be separated from Iman. It is called Iman in the Book of Allah Ta'ala. And of course, it's kind of obvious, the Shaykh didn't mention it, that this text from Shaykh al-Islam, the author. It's taken directly from a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, and this is closer to the wording of al-Imam Muslim here. It's called Hadithu Shu'ab al-Iman, the hadith of the branches of faith, from the narration of Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And with that, we'll suffice ourselves for this week. We begin to study the pillars of Iman, the six pillars of Iman, in great detail, insha'Allahu ta'ala, in our lessons to come. We thank Allahu ta'ala for what He has bestowed upon us of His grace, and we ask Him for an increase. And we end this session by sending salat and salam upon the finest of creation, Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. In the hadith of Shu'ab al-Iman, there are three examples given. One of them is قَوْلُ لَا إِلَهَا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Perhaps he means that this is قَوْلٌ بِاللِّسَانِ. Then الْحَيَاءُ, perhaps he's thinking of the result of haya being al-istihya, the behavior of modesty, that is an action, not the presence of the root of modesty in the heart. If he's thinking of it like that, then these all appear to be actions, statements and actions. And Allahu Ta'ala knows best. But as mentioned to you, one of the early authors, specialists in this hadith, he wrote 10 volumes on this one hadith. 10 volumes to explain this hadith. And in that massive work that is considered a classic in hadith literature, on the topic especially, he mentions 77 branches, 77 chapters. The first six are as explained. They are the six pillars of Iman. That seems to be the first thing that comes to your mind, especially when you're told أَعْلَاهَا قَوْلُ لَا إِلَهَا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The highest branch of faith is that none deserve worship other than Allah. That is your Iman, billahi. Right? And it happens to be a statement. Just like your belief in the angels must be affirmed verbally. It's not sufficient to say, I believe in the angels in my heart. If someone asks me, do I believe in angels? I'm going to say, Allahu A'lam, Allah knows best. And I'm going to refrain from a verbal affirmation. Rather, you must attest to everything that is Iman verbally and have no problem in doing so. For your Iman to be intact, it can't be a set of beliefs that you have in your heart that you refuse to verbalize, as this is contradictory to the understanding of Iman from the book and the Sunnah. And Allahu Ta'ala knows best. But his angle, I think we've provided something for his angle, that the three things mentioned in the hadith of Shu'ab, they can be understood as actions. Aqaw, istihya, the manifestation of shyness in one's actions, and removing a harm from the way of the people. Those can be actions. So the branches of faith are not the foundations. I guess he's also looking at the word shu'ab versus usul. The branch is something that comes off of something. They're called branches in English, the shu'ab. So then there has to be an usul. In this case, there are six usul. There are six foundational pillars or posts that these shu'ab come up off of. And perhaps he's looking at it in that way. And Allahu Ta'ala knows best. At the end of the day, both ways of looking at the issue still affirm all six pillars of Iman as a necessary requirement for any believer. And then all of the action statements and manifestations of Iman that are the 70-some branches are also definitely from Islam and not to be explained away as anything other than acts of worship and Iman. And Allahu Ta'ala knows best. Wa salli Allahumma wa sallim wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.